the name of Jesus Christ. I see him deliver you from every oppression of the devil in the name of Jesus Christ.
Be born again. Change your roots from being the seed of Ham, the seed of Cana, be the seed of Abraham. Because the blessing will come on the seed of Abraham. On behalf of God the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit, you're welcome to this Eden Blessing Sunday. We are looking at the topic, living in the blessing. Subtopic, the blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich. The blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich. The blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich. We have seen so far that when God created man, the first thing that God put on man was the blessing. The first word that man ever had from the mouth of God was, "You are blessed." Genesis chapter 1 in verses 27 and 28. Genesis chapter 1 verses 27 and 28. 1, 2, 3, let's read. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created him, male and female created them. And God blessed them. And God said unto them, "Be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth." After God created man, male and female created them, God blessed them. So the first thing that God ever did to man after he created him, male and female, he blessed them. He blessed them. He blessed them. He declared them blessed. That means the will of God for man is for man to stay on this earth blessed. Remember, the Bible says, "I am the Lord, I change not." God's will concerning man has not changed. When man failed, God began to work a plan how to bring man to his original will. So God does not have any other will different from his original will. Genesis, from Genesis chapter 3 up to Revelation 22, God is restoring man to Genesis chapter 1 verses 28. So all that God has been doing since the fall of man is to restore man to his original will, which is Genesis chapter 1 verses 28, that man should return back to being blessed. And he blessed them. He declared them blessed. And then he said,
Because you are blessed, be fruitful. Because you are blessed, multiply. Because you are blessed, replenish the earth. Because you are blessed, subdue the earth. Because you are blessed, have dominion over the earth. And then he took man, put him in the Garden of Eden for him to fulfill Genesis 1:28. So what was the purpose of the blessing on Adam? The purpose of the blessing was for Adam to maintain the Garden of Eden. In the Garden of Eden, there was fruitfulness. In the Garden of Eden, there was multiplication. In the Garden of Eden, there was abundance. In the Garden of Eden, there were riches. The Garden of Eden was a replicate of God's life on the earth. So God gave man the blessing so that man will use the blessing to maintain the Garden of Eden and to spray the Garden of Eden to the entire earth. God's original plan was that the entire earth will be like the Garden of Eden. So Adam with the blessing was to maintain the Garden of Eden. And Adam with the blessing, he was supposed to spray the Garden of Eden onto the entire earth. As he entered up to there, before God created man, he had a plan for man. And the plan for man, before even God created man, was for man to live in the Garden of Eden. The Garden of Eden was a replicate of heaven on earth. The Garden of Eden was a replicate of eternal life. The God kind of abundant life. Now look at Titus chapter 1.
Angalia waraka wa Tito moja.
Titus chapter 1.
Waraka wa Tito moja.
Titus is after 2 Timothy.
Baada ya Timotheo wa pili.
Titus chapter 1.
Waraka wa Tito moja.
Let's read verses 1 and 2.
Tusome moja na mbili.
Titus chapter 1. Verses 1 and 2. 1, 2, 3, let's read. Paul, a servant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect, and the acknowledging of the truth which is after godliness, in hope of eternal life, which God, that cannot lie, promised before the world began. Let's read verses 2 again. In hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. So before the world began, God purposed that man will live on this earth and he will live eternal life on this earth. Let's read verses 2 again. In hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. So, even before God created the earth, even before God created the universe, God purposed to create man and then put man on the earth for him to live the God kind of abundant life. Paul is saying, in hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie, he has no change and he cannot lie, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. So God created the earth And then God created the Garden of Eden and put man in the Garden of Eden to live eternal life. What is eternal life? Many people say Maisha Milele. I don't know what Maisha Milele means. But eternal life means the God kind of abundant life. The God kind of abundant life.
Yale maisha utele kama wake Mungu.
The God kind of abundant life.
Yale maisha utele kama wake Mungu.
Zoe.
Yale maisha Zoe.
What is Zoe?
Zoe,
Zoe is the God kind of abundant life.
Yale maisha utele kama
Zoe
Mungu.
Is the life of God.
Yale maisha ya Mungu.
Eternal life is the life of God.
Yale maisha kama yake Mungu.
So God purposed before he created the earth,
kabla umbe
before athi, even he created man, he purposed that man on this earth he will live his life. God said, well, I'm going to create man and I will give him my life. I will give him my life. He will live my life on the earth. He will live my life on the earth. So God created the earth for man. God created the Garden of Eden for man so that man can live the God kind of abundant life in the Garden of Eden. Are you catching this thing? Let's read verses 2 again. In hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. He promised before the world did what? God purposed that man will live his life before even he began to create the world. God purposed that man will live his life even before he created man. Did you catch it? So when he began to create the world, he was creating the earth for man. Are you catching this thing? He created the Garden of Eden for man. Because before man came, God purposed that man will live his life on the earth. Before even he said, let there be light, he already purposed that man will live on this earth and I will give him my life. So light was created for man. The fish was created for man. Did you catch it? The earth was created for man. The waters were created for man. That is why he said, have dominion over the fish. These things have been created for you. I purposed that these things will be there for you before I created you, before I created them. So the earth was created for man. The Garden of Eden was created for man. So the Garden of Eden lifestyle is a replicate of God's life on the earth. That was the life that man was supposed to live on the earth. As he entered, in hope, let's read again for better understanding. In hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. He promised before the world began. He promised that man will live Zoe life, that man will live his life on the earth before the world began. That means everything that was created for man. Did you catch it? He purposed that man would live his life on the earth before the world began. He didn't create the earth for the fish. He didn't create the earth for the lion. He didn't create abundance for the lion. He created everything on the earth for man. He created the Garden of Eden for man. And then he told man, this is the life I purposed you to live before I created these things. These things are created for you, so enjoy them, but make sure you stay away from that fruit. So God's will for man is for man to live the Garden of Eden lifestyle on the earth. Did you catch it? Now, the Garden of Eden is what is Iraq today. So God called a big land like the country of Iraq a garden. That means God wanted man to live a very comfortable life. He wanted man to live his life on the earth. He wanted man to live heaven on earth. Iraq, that was the Garden of Eden. When the blessing left, the place deteriorated up to what it is today. But imagine that was somebody's compound. Iraq, that was somebody's compound. One person with a wife, that was his compound. That was a compound of a couple, the whole of the nation of Iraq. All the wealth there, that was one couple's wealth. Man was created to live God's life on the earth, and Jesus came to bring that life. John 10:10. John 10:10. John chapter 10, verses 10. Are you there? 1, 2, 3, let's read. John 10:10. The thief cometh not but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. What life? Zoe. I have come that they may have Zoe life, which God promised before the world began. I have come to restore them to God's purpose for their lives. This is God's purpose for their lives, that they should live Zoe life. That is what God purposed before he created man. That is what God purposed before he created the earth. That is what God purposed before he created the Garden of Eden. I have come to bring Zoe to you. I have come to bring the God kind of abundant life to you. I have come to restore to you the Garden of Eden. I have come that you may have life, not ordinary life, eternal life, Zoe life, the life of God. I have come that you may have Zoe life, the life of God on the earth. So I have come to bring to you the Garden of Eden, because the Garden of Eden, that was the replicate of eternal life. That was a replicate of the God kind of abundant life on the earth. Did you catch it? What is the purpose of the blessing? The purpose of the blessing was to maintain, number one, eternal life. Zoe, the Garden of Eden. Number two, the purpose of the blessing was to spread the Garden of Eden unto the entire earth. And Jesus said, I have come to restore to you the Zoe life, the eternal life. I have come to restore to you the blessing. And the blessing will make you rich. And the blessing will work 24 hours to create the Garden of Eden and to push away everything that is designed to bring sorrow into your life. In Proverbs chapter 10, look at Proverbs chapter 10. Now, from that scripture, is it God's will for you to prosper? He created you for the Garden of Eden. He created you for abundance. Look, God never created abundance for the devil. He never created abundance for Freemasons. He never created abundance for the witches. He didn't create abundance for the children of Satan. He created abundance for his own family. Adam and Eve, that was God's family on the earth. So God wanted his family on the earth to live his life. And he gave them his life in the Garden of Eden. Proverbs 10:22. Proverbs 10:22. 1, 2, 3, let's read. The blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich, and he added no sorrow with it. The blessing of the Lord, it maketh what? Rich. The blessing of the Lord, it maketh what? Rich. And added no sorrow with it. When God created man, the first thing that God gave to man was what? The blessing. So God's will for man, God's will for his family, God's will for his children is to live a rich life without sorrow. That means the believers, they prosper in the blessing, and the blessing ensures that there is no sorrow in your life. What does it mean to be rich? Let's define rich. What does the Bible mean to be rich? Having plenty with no sorrow. To do whatever you want to do all the time. Having plenty with no sorrow. To do whatever you want to do at all times. Having plenty. Having abundance. To do what you want to do without sorrow all the time. Having abundance, having plenty with no sorrow to do whatever you want to do at all times. Rich means having a strong, healthy family. Having a strong, healthy family. And having a strong, healthy future. Having a strong, healthy family. And having a strong, healthy future. So the blessing of the Lord makes you rich. Causes abundance to come into your life. Causes plenty to come into your life. To do whatever you want to do. And put pushes away whatever is designed to bring sorrow into your life. The blessing will work to give you a strong, healthy family and a strong, healthy future. With the blessing, your future is guaranteed. With the blessing, your future is guaranteed. With the blessing, your future is guaranteed. So the blessing works to cause you to have a strong and a healthy family and a strong and a healthy future. The believers, God has designed that the believers should prosper in the blessing. When you prosper in the blessing, there will be no sorrow. Now there are two systems of prosperity: God's system and the world system. Psalm 73, verses 12. 1, 2, 3, let's read. Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increase in riches. These are the ungodly. They prosper where? In the world. Now the world is not the earth. The world there is the Babylonian system of commerce. The Babylonian system of handling finances. They are ungodly. They prosper in the world. They prosper in the Babylonian system of commerce. They prosper in the Babylonian system of handling finances. What is the Babylonian system of commerce? Now the Babylonian system of commerce is a system that operates without God. Is a system of commerce that operates without God. Is a system of commerce that does not involve God. Does not involve the principles of God in its finances, in its business, in its career. These are the ungodly. So the ungodly, they prosper in the Babylonian system. A system that functions minus God. The Babylonian system is a system where Satan is the God over that system. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. 2 Corinthians 4, 3 and 4. 1, 2, 3, let's read. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, shall shine unto them. The God of what? This world. Not the earth. No. The God of the Babylonian system of commerce. The ungodly, they prosper in the world. They prosper in the Babylonian system. And in whom the God of the Babylonian system has blinded the minds of them which believe not. Satan tells the ungodly, you don't need God, you're fine, you're doing good. A little problem here and there, no bad. Sorrow is common. I mean, you don't need God, you're okay. So the ungodly, they prosper in the world. They prosper prosper in the Babylonian system. They prosper in the system whereby Satan is the one in charge. That is why the Babylonian system is always available for shake-up. Because the one that is in charge is a thief. He's a thief. He's a killer. And he's a destroyer. The one that is in charge of the Babylonian system is a thief, is a killer, and is a destroyer. So when you operate in the Babylonian system of commerce, you may prosper fine, but there will be sorrow. So the ungodly, they prosper in the world, but their prosperity in the world is accompanied with sorrow. But they that prosper in the blessing, the blessing, it maketh rich and it pushes away sorrow. So there is prosperity in the blessing, and there is prosperity in the Babylonian system. When you live by the principles of God, the principles of God, the principles of finances of God, then you will prosper in the blessing, and the blessing will shield you from sorrow. The blessing will push away the effects of sorrow from your life. So when you prosper in the blessing, there will be no sorrow. When you prosper in the world, there will be sorrow. So when you live outside the blessing, in your marriage, in your finances, in your business, in your health, there will be sorrow. If you live outside the blessing, there will be sorrow. There will be sorrow in your marriage. There will be sorrow in your business. There will be sorrow in your career. There will be sorrow in your finances. There will be sorrow in your health. They that prosper in the world, it is accompanied with sorrow. But they that prosper in the blessing will shield you from sorrow, because the blessing works 24 hours to create the Garden of Eden and to push away the effects of sorrow from your life. Now, Psalms 112 is covenant description of God's view on a prosperous man. Psalms 112 is God's view of a prosperous man. Now let's look at this man in what makes him to prosper. Let's read from verses 1 out of verses 10, and then we come back, break one by one. 1, 2, 3, let's read together. Praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord, that delighteth greatly in his commandments. His seed shall be mighty upon the earth. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. Wealth and riches shall be in his house, and his righteousness endureth forever. Unto the upright there ariseth light in the darkness. He is righteous and full of compassion and righteous. A good man showeth favor and lendeth. He will guide his affairs with discretion. Surely it shall not be moved forever. The righteous shall be in everlasting remembrance. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. His heart is established. He shall not be afraid until he see his desire upon his enemies. He has dispersed. He has given to the poor. His righteousness endureth forever. His horn shall be exalted with honor. The wicked shall see it and be grieved. He shall gnash with his teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked shall perish. Now, this is a prosperous man in the blessing.
Mwenye ufanisi katika upako.
This is God's description of a prosperous man in the blessing. This is God's description of a prosperous man in the blessing. How does it begin? Verses 1. Let's read verses 1. Praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord, that delighted greatly in his commandments. How did God begin? In Genesis 1:28. And God blessed them. God's view of a prosperous man in God, he has to be blessed. And this man is blessed. He's blessed. He's blessed. He has paid the price for the blessing. That means this man is a tither, number one. So to prosper in the blessing, number one, you must be a tither. Praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord, that delighted greatly in his commandments. So this man is blessed. This man is a tither. This man has become a partaker of the calling of Jesus Christ in the office of Melchizedek. Number two, this man fears God. So the fear of God activates the blessing. Blessed is the man that feared the Lord, that delighted greatly in his commandments. So this man fears God. So to prosper in the blessing, to prosper in God, you must fear God. What does it mean to fear God? A man that fears God means you have given God the first place in your life. God has the first priority in your life. He fears God. He has given God first place, first priority in his life. To fear God means you walk in the light that you already have. You walk in the revelational knowledge that you already have while you are looking for more. You are walking in the revelational knowledge that you already have while you are looking for more. That means you are not satisfied. You are still digging deep. You still want to walk with him deeper. You still want to walk with God intimately. So you are walking in the revelation that you already have, and you are still looking for more, so that you can have a deeper, intimate relationship with God. You want to have a deeper fellowship with God. You are not only satisfied with where you are. You want to walk with him. You want to be like Enoch. And Enoch walked with God. And God said, I like you so much. And God took him. Enoch did not see death. Enoch did not see the grave. He walked with God to the level that he went to have some time with God. And God said, I like your company. You are not going back. So you're walking in the light. You're walking in the revelation that you already have, but you're not satisfied. You are still digging more. You want to have a deeper, intimate relationship with God. You want to know him more. You want to experience him more. That is the man that will prosper in the blessing. You catching this thing? What does it mean to fear God? To fear God means you reverence God. You reverence God. You take the things of God serious. Serious. When it comes to God, it's serious business. You reverence Him. You reverence Him. There are things you cannot do in the presence of God. There are things you cannot do because you fear God. You reverence Him. You reverence Him. You want to please Him all the time. Jesus said, my Father is with me. He has not left me because I always do those things that please Him. You reverence Him. You reverence Him. His presence, the consciousness of God, means so much to you. So you reverence God. It means you live your life according to what He says. You live your life according to what He says. If He says, give this, you say, yes, sir. You live. You are ready to obey His commands. That means to honor Him. It means to honor God. That means you give God the honor, or you allow God to speak to you and you obey Him. You allow Him. Say, God, speak to me anything. Rebuke to me in any way. You allow God to speak to you. You allow God to speak to your life. And you say, yes, sir. Taking God as right all the time, you honor Him. You allow Him to speak to your life and you obey Him. Did you catch it? To fear God means you follow Him. Allow Him to be the shepherd over your life. Psalms 23, verses 1. The Lord is my shepherd. Therefore, I shall not lack. When He's not your shepherd, you will lack. You allow God to lead you and be humble enough to follow God. That is the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord means when something is taught and you are not doing it, you immediately effect the changes in your life. When you hear something from the Word of God and you have not been doing it, you immediately adjust your life to the Word of God. When you hear this is wrong, you say, hey, from today off, I'm going to live in line with the Word of God. So, to fear God means you immediately adjust your life to the Word of God. When you hear something that you didn't know before, when you hear something that you are not doing before, you immediately adjust your life and you begin to do it. That is to fear the Lord. To prosper in God and activate the blessing to make you rich and activate the blessing to create the garden of Eden in your life and push away sorrow from your life, you have to walk in the fear of the Lord. Are you catching this thing? That is what made Joseph to prosper. Look at Genesis chapter 42. Genesis 42, verses 18. 1, 2, 3, if you are there, let's read. And Joseph said unto them the third day, these do and live, for I fear God. I fear God. He is my first priority. I fear him. I reverence him. I honor him. I give him the honor to speak to me. And I obey him. I want to please him all the time. I fear him. So it is the fear of the Lord in the life of Joseph that made the blessing to work for him. Look at Genesis 39. Genesis 39. Let's read verses 1 up to verses 7. Verses 6 first. 1, 2, 3. Let's read. And Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him of the hands of the Ishmaelites, which had brought him down to the down there. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master the Egyptian. Let's stop there. He was what? He was what? A prosperous man. So the fear of the Lord activates the blessing to make you a prosperous man. He said, I fear God. There are things I can do because I fear God. He's my first priority. He has a first place in my life. I allow him to speak to me and I obey him. I fear God. So the fear of God activated the blessing in the life of Joseph, and the blessing made him rich. Verses 2 again. Then we read downwards. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master the Egyptian. And he saw, his master saw, that the Lord was with him, and the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hands. And Joseph found grace in his sight, and he served him, and he made him overseer over his house and all that he had. He put it into his hands, and it came to pass from the time that he made him overseer in his house and over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake, and the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he did in the house and in the field. Let's stop there. Are you seeing the blessing? Are you seeing the blessing? The blessing. The blessing of the Lord was upon all that he did, and in the house and in the field. The blessing of the Lord in the life of Joseph made Potiphar to be so rich that Potiphar didn't know how to do accounts anymore. He left everything to Joseph. The ranch multiplied. Money multiplied. He lost count of everything. He said, man, God is with you. You are in charge. The blessing of the Lord. The Bible, let's read verses 5 again. And it came to pass from the time that he made him overseer in his house and over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake, and the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and in the field, because he feared God. The blessing was working on him. The blessing was working, creating the Garden of Eden in the ranch of Potiphar. Hello? The blessing on Joseph was working, creating the Garden of Eden in the ranch of Potiphar, in the house, in the field, until Potiphar said, take over. The multiplication was too much. Potiphar became so rich because of the blessing that was on Joseph. But Joseph said he retained that blessing because he feared God. So when you walk in the fear of God, you activate the blessing, and the blessing will make you rich in the field, will make you rich in your business, will make you rich in your career will make you rich, even in your house. Hello? And then the man goes to prison. Let's look at verses 19. 1, 2, 3, let's go. And it came to pass, when his master heard the words of his wife, which she spake unto him, saying, After this manner did thy servant to me, that his wrath was kindled. And Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, a place where the king's prisoners are bound. And he was there in the prison. But the Lord was with Joseph, and he showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison committed to Joseph's hand all the prisoners that were in the prison. And whatsoever they did there, he was the doer of it. And the keeper of the prison looked not to anything that was under his hand, because the Lord was with him. In that which he did, the Lord made it to prosper. What? The blessing is still creating the garden of Eden for him in the prison. You can't keep him down. You can't keep a blessed man down. A man who walks in the fear of the Lord, activating the blessing, no matter what you do to him, he will still spring up. The blessing is like a springboard. You try to push him down, and the blessing will push him up. So to prosper in God, to prosper in the blessing, you have to walk in the fear of the Lord. And anywhere, now the blessing does not know whether there is a hard place or no hard place. The blessing does not know whether where you started, whether men are there or men are not there. The blessing works to create the garden of Eden wherever you are. The blessing will make that business to prosper wherever you are. The blessing will change environment into the garden of Eden. The blessing will change a terrible place into the garden of Eden. The blessing will change a business that was not selling into a business that deserving boom. The blessing will change a department that was not functioning into the most outstanding department in the company. The blessing. The blessing. The blessing. So God's view of a prosperous man, you have to prosper in the blessing, and to prosper in the blessing, you have to walk in the fear of the Lord. Let's go back to Psalms 112. So let's read verses 1 again. 1, 2, 3. Praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord, that delighted greatly in his commandments. Number 3. He delighted greatly in his commandments. He's a word addict. He won't do anything outside the word of God. He won't do anything outside the word of God. No matter what you do to him, he will not stop doing the word. In the recession, he will do the word. In the famine, he will do the word. When there is any crisis, he still sticks with the word. When they say, what shall we do? They say, let me find out from my heavenly Father, what he wants us to do. He delights greatly in the commandments of the Lord. He's a word addict. He's committed to the word. He won't do anything outside the word. And that activates the blessing. Hello? Remember last Sunday we saw that faith activates the blessing. How does faith come? By hearing, and hearing by the word of God. How does your faith produce results? By doing what you have heard. So this man, he's addicted to the word. His lifestyle is based on the word of God. He relates to people based on the word of God. It doesn't relate with people based on the flesh. No. If you step on his toes, he's not going to roar at you like a lion. He will say, I forgive you. I forgive you, my brother. I forgive you, my sister. He delights greatly in the commandments of the Lord. He's addicted to the word of God. You want to take him out of the word, he says, no way. I know where I should. I know where to prosper. I prosper in the word. No matter what you do to provoke him, to take him out of the word, he says, no way. This is where I will stay. I'm safe here. The grace to be addicted to the word. Receive it in the name of Jesus Christ. Receive it in the name of Jesus Christ. Then, what will be the result? Verses 2. His seed shall be mighty upon the earth. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. So when you prosper in the blessing, by walking in the fear of the Lord, and by delighting greatly in the commandments of God, your children will be more prosperous than you. That is a good heritage. When you prosper in the blessing, your children will be more blessed than you. Is that not what you desire? Is that not what you desire? That your generations to come after you will be more blessed, will be more prosperous than you. So when you prosper in the blessing, your children, your generations that follow you will be more prosperous than you. But the same is not in the world. In the world, when they that prosper in the world, it's different. When the parents, some even kill their parents to take the wealth. And then that killing brings sorrow. It brings a curse of bloodshed and a curse on the generations to come. So what they thought will make them happy, it brings sorrow. To some in the world, it is court battles. Court battles. And all that was left eventually is used to cut off court expenses. By the time the court cases are over, what remains after the expenses is very little. So in the world, the heritage is passed over with sorrow, but it is not so in the blessing. May you prosper in the blessing in the name of Jesus Christ. Verses 3. 1, 2, 3, let's read. Wealth and riches shall be in his house. His righteousness endureth forever. What will be in his house? The man who fears God, the man who is blessed and fears God and delights greatly in the commandments of God, he has a house. And that house has riches and wealth. He has a house, and that house has wealth and riches. That's God's view of a prosperous man in the blessing. That when you prosper in the blessing, you will have a house, and your house will have wealth and what? Riches. Will have wealth and what? Riches. But religion has blinded the believers. Religion tells the believers, no, you know, if you are rich, you can't go to heaven. What was God's purpose for creating man? For man to live his life. Is God poor? No. So God never intended for man to live a poor life. God intended for man to live his life. And in heaven where God is living, streets are paved with gold. Hello, houses. He says the houses they are built with precious stones. Is a place of riches. Lami ya mbinguni ni gold.
Lami ya uko.
Lami.
Barabara.
The dust in heaven is gold. So God, that is why he will supply your demands according to his riches. He's not poor. He has riches according to his riches. He is rich according to his riches. So a man that is blessed and he fears God and he delights greatly in the commandments of God, this man will have a house. And in his house, there will be wealth and there will be riches. May that be you in the name of Jesus Christ. May that be you in the name of Jesus Christ. May that be you in the name of Jesus Christ. May that be you in the name of Jesus Christ. So wealth and riches will be in his house. Verses 4. 1, 2, 3, let's read. Unto the upright, there ariseth light in the darkness. He is gracious and full of compassion and righteous. Unto the upright, there ariseth light in the darkness. He knows what to do during a recession. He knows what to do during the famine. He knows what to do when there is earthquake. He knows what to do. What does this do? He stays in the word. He stays in the light. He stays in the light. God came to Isaac in Genesis 26. Isaac wanted to go to Egypt. And God said, no. No. When there is these things in the Babylonian system, that's not the time to be running away. Because wherever you go to, these things can reach you there. So what you need to do, stay where you are. I will bless you. Okay, let's have a look at it. Genesis 26. Genesis 26. Verses 1 up to verses 5. 1, 2, 3, let's read. Are you there? Let's go. And there was a famine in the land beside the first famine that was in the days of Abraham. And Isaac went unto Abimelech, king of the Philistines, unto Gerar. And the Lord appeared unto him and said, go not down into Egypt, dwell in the land which I shall tell thee of. Sojourn in this land, and I will be with thee, and will bless thee. For unto thee and unto thy seed will I give all these countries, and I will perform the oath which I swear unto Abraham your father. And I will make thy seed to multiply as the stars of heaven, and I will give unto thy seed all these countries, and in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because that Abraham obeyed my voice, kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my law. Stay where you are. Verses 3. Sojourn in this land, and I will be with you, and I will bless you. I will bless you. And when I bless you, do what your father did. What did the father do? Verses 5. 1, 2, 3, let's read. Because that Abraham obeyed my voice, kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws, do this, you will activate the blessing. And the blessing in the midst of this famine, the blessing will make you rich. Famine can't stop the blessing from creating the Garden of Eden. Famine can't stop the blessing from creating the Garden of Eden. In the midst of the famine, the blessing will create the Garden of Eden, and it will push away the effects of famine from your life and from everything that concerned you. This man, the upright, he's not afraid of darkness. Why? He has light. He has light. He knows what to do. In the midst of famine, he stays in the world. He stays in the world. He activates the blessing. The blessing works to create the Garden of Eden for him and to push away the effects of famine, recession, depression away from his life. Hello? Look at verses 12 up to 14. 1, 2, 3, let's read. Then Isaac sowed in that land and received in the same year 100-fold, and the Lord blessed him. Stop there. Did the famine stop him? Did the famine stop him? Did the famine stop him? If you have business, I decree with a blessing, your goods will still be bought supernaturally in the name of Jesus Christ. Even if they are saying there are no jobs, the blessing will get for you one in the name of Jesus Christ. The blessing will get for you one in the name of Jesus Christ. And the Lord blessed him. And the blessing worked and created the Garden of Eden and pushed away the effects of recession away from his life onto the upright. There ariseth light in darkness. He knows what to do, so darkness cannot hold him bondage. Hello? Verses 13 and 15. And the man works great and went forward and grew until he became very great. Let's stop there. In this famine, in this inflation, in this recession, you will not suffer stagnation. You will go forward in the name of Jesus Christ. You will go forward in the name of Jesus Christ. That means nothing stops a blessed man. Recession can't stop him. Inflation cannot stop him. Economic downturn cannot stop him. In the midst of these things, a blessed man is still going forward. He's still increasing. He's still becoming great. That will be your portion this year in the name of Jesus Christ. You will not cry the way other Kenyans cry in the name of Jesus Christ. You will not cry the way other Kenyans cry in the name of Jesus Christ. We are the Isaacs of this generation. Did you catch it? We are the Isaacs of this what? Generation. The way God treated Isaac in his generation, that is how God will treat us in this generation. If we remain blessed, obey his commandments, obey his voice, obey his statutes, obey his laws, you will be the Isaac of this generation in the name of Jesus Christ. Verses 14. For yet possession of flocks and possession of herds and a great store of servants, and the Philistines envied him. You will be envied in the name of Jesus Christ. You will be envied in the name of Jesus Christ. You will be envied in the name of Jesus Christ. Psalms 112. God's view of a prosperous man in the blessing. Verses 4. Unto the upright there ariseth light in the darkness. He is gracious and full of compassion and righteous. Verses 5. A good man showeth favor and lendeth. He will guide his affairs with discretion. This is a man that is committed to God. He's committed to the agenda of God. He will show favor to the agenda of God. And he will also help those that are in need. He showeth favor and lending. He helps those who are in need according to his level. He helps. He showeth favor to the agenda of God. Look at Psalms 102. Psalms 102 verses 13 and 14. verses 13 and 14. Psalms 102, 13 and 14. 1, 2, 3, let's read. Thou shalt arise and have mercy upon Zion, for the time to favor her. Yea, the set time is come. For thy servants, they take pleasure in her stones, and they favor the dust thereof. They take pleasure in serving God. Thy servants. Who is a servant? A servant is the one who serves. He serves. Thy servants take pleasure in her stones. What is the stones? The stone stands for the agenda of God. The agenda of God. The projects of God. The work of God. And favors the dust thereof. He favors even the minutest details in the house of God. He is interested in the minutest details. He doesn't ignore even the minutest details in the house of God. When he sees something that needs to be worked on, even if it's little, he does it. He favors even the dust thereof. He favors the dust thereof. He serves God with his strength, with his means, with his skills, and even the smallest things in the house of God, he doesn't ignore. He gets involved to work on them. He showeth favor. Thou shalt arise and have mercy. The word mercy there means to turn the captivity of Zion. Zion is not the building. Zion is the believers. Thou shalt arise. Turn the captivity of the believers. For the time to favor her. Yea, the set time is come. Why? Thy servants have discovered what to do. They take pleasure in her stones. And they favor the smallest details in the house of the Lord. It's time for you to turn their captivity, for they now know what to do. Now let's go back to Psalms 112. Psalms 112, verses 5. 1, 2, 3, let's go. A good man showeth favor and lend it. He will guide his affairs with discretion. He showeth favor to the work of God. He showeth favor to the smallest details in the house of God. He showeth favor to the smallest things in the house of God. And he helps people. He helps people. He is a helper of people. He is a helper of people. He guides affairs with discretion. You know why he guides his affairs with discretion? He's blessed. His mind is blessed. So he thinks right. He thinks right. His mind is anointed. He guides affairs with discretion. Discretion means you are able to make sound decisions. Sound judgments. Because he's blessed. His mind is blessed. His mind is anointed. He thinks right. He reasons right. He receives inspiration from God. He receives ideas from God. He makes sound decisions. He makes sound judgments. He doesn't make judgments based on anger. He doesn't make judgments based on emotions. He doesn't make judgments based on excitement. He makes judgment based on inspiration, on divine ideas. God inspires his mind, so he's able to make sound decisions, sound judgments. He thinks right. That will be you from today in the name of Jesus Christ. I decree your mind is blessed in the name of Jesus Christ. Verses 6. Surely he shall not be moved forever. The righteous shall be in everlasting remembrance. God can't forget him. Why? He is blessed. He fears God. He delights greatly in the commandments of God. God has him in his mind. That is why when Joseph was put in the pit, God had him in his mind. He made sure a caravan passed by there so that he will be sold and will not die. He had him in his mind. When he reached Egypt, he made sure that a good man bought him. He had him in his mind. When he was sent to prison, God had him in his mind. He didn't leave him. So when you're blessed, you fear God, you delight greatly in the commandments of God, you take pleasure in the work of God, you favor the minor duties in the house of God, God has you in his mind. He, the Bible says in Psalms 111, just there, Psalms 111 verses 5, you are near there, just read it. 1, 2, 3, let's read. Psalms 111 verses 5. He has given meat unto them that fear him. He will ever be mindful of his covenant. This blessed man is a covenant man. So God is mindful of his covenant. That means the Amplified Bible says God has imprinted the covenant in his mind. So when you are a covenant man, God has you in his mind. So you are always in his mind. He will not forget you. He has you. He has you in the forehead of his mind to do you good. Let's read verses 6 again. Psalms 112, 6. Surely he shall not be moved forever. The righteous shall be in everlasting remembrance. This time, just like God never forgot Joseph, in this time of famine, recession, inflation, God will remember you. I say God will remember you. Verses 7 and 8. 1, 2, 3. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. His heart is established. He shall not be afraid until he see his desire upon his enemies. He's not afraid of evil tidings. He's not afraid of inflation. He's not afraid of retrenchment, because his name will not be among the people that will be retrenched. He's not afraid of inflation. He's not afraid of inflation. Recession. He's not afraid of earthquakes. He's not afraid of evil tidings. Why? His heart is fixed. Where is his heart fixed? His heart is fixed in the word of God. His heart is fixed in the word of God. He trusts the Lord. I know he can't lie. I trust him. He has to do what he said he would do. He's a covenant keeping God. If he doesn't do what he has promised to do, when I've done my part, he has to die, because he walked in the blood. I trust him. So his heart is fixed in the Lord. Verses 8. His heart is established in the word. He shall not be afraid. Now listen to me. Jesus said, it is not the evil things that destroy believers. No. It is the foundation that they have built their lives on. This man has built this foundation on the rock, which is the word of God. Luke chapter 6. From verses 46. Are you there? Luke 6:46 up to 49. 1, 2, 3, let's read. 1, 2, 3, let's go. And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Whosoever cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doeth them, I will show you to whom he is like. He is like a man which built an house and dig deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently upon the house and could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock. But he that heareth and doeth not is like a man that without a foundation built an house upon the earth, against which the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great. What made one house to fall and the other not to fall? The foundation. The foundation. It is not evil that destroys believers. It is the foundation that they have built their lives on. The first man, he heard the sayings of Jesus and he did them. So he laid his life, he laid his foundation on the word of God. So the storms came, the inflation came, retrenchment came, recession came, earthquakes came, plagues came, but could not destroy him. But the same inflation, the same depression, the same earthquakes, the same famine came against the other believer. And it hit him, and the other believer fell, crushed. Why did the other believer fail? He built his life on the foundation of the sun. What is the sun? The sun is building your life on the principles of the Babylonian system. These are the ungodly. They prosper in the world, in the Babylonian system. When you build your life outside the word of God, you are building your life on the sand, on the Babylonian system. When recession comes, when famine comes, when depression comes, it will hit you and you will crash. You didn't crash because the evil was strong. You crashed because your foundation was the sand, the Babylonian system principles. So the Psalms 112 man, his heart is fixed in the word of God. You can't get him there. You can't get him from the principles of Jesus. You can't get him from the sayings of Jesus. His heart is established in the sayings of Jesus. He's not afraid of the evil tidings, because even if they come, there is a blessing wall. There is a blessing wall. There is a blessing wall. Those things cannot be able to go through the blessing wall. There is a blessing wall that this evil cannot go through to access it. No evil will come upon you this year in the name of Jesus Christ. If you believe it, can you shout a bigger amen? Now look at Genesis, very fast. 47. Genesis 47. Let's read verses 20. Verses 15 first. 20. And then verses 27. 1, 2, 3. Let's read verses 15. And when money failed in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan, all the Egyptians came unto Joseph and said, give us bread, for why should we die in thy presence, for the money faileth. Verses 20. And Joseph bought all the land of Egypt for Pharaoh, for the Egyptians sold every man his field, because the famine prevailed over them. So the land became Pharaoh's. Verses 27. And Israel dwelt in the land of Egypt, in the country of Goshen, and they had possessions therein, and grew and multiplied exceedingly. What happened? There was the blessing wall. The blessing wall. This blessing wall came from Joseph. Goshen was the property that was given to Joseph by Potiphar. So the blessing was on Goshen. So there was the blessing wall in Goshen. Although money failed in Egypt, although in other provinces of Egypt, famine prevailed, money failed. But in the province of Goshen, in the same country, there was abundance. Possessions were increasing. Cows were increasing. Wealth was increasing. Why? The blessing wall. It is not evil that destroys believers. It is the foundation on which they are build their lives on. Build your life on the word of God, and the blessing wall will shield you. As it is shielding you, it is creating the garden of Eden for you. So the blessing created the garden of Eden in Goshen and shielded Goshen from the effects of depression, money failure, and famine. That will be your portion in the name of Jesus Christ. No evil will come upon you in the name of Jesus Christ. Whatever makes victims or people in the world will never come near you in the name of Jesus Christ. From here, we'll continue next Sunday. I want you to ask God, God, give me the grace to walk in the blessing. Give me the grace to walk in the fear of the Lord. Give me the grace to delight greatly in your commandments, in Jesus' name. Let's go ahead and pray that prayer. God to give you the grace. You need his grace to walk in the blessing, and the blessing will make you rich. The blessing will shield you from sorrow. The blessing wall will protect you from the storms, from the recessions, from the depressions, in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, give me the grace. I want to walk in the blessing. I want to walk in the blessing. I want to walk in the fear of the Lord. I want to delight greatly in your commandments. In Jesus' name, Heavenly Father, I want to favor your house. I want to favor your house. I want to help people where I can. Lord, give me the grace. The grace to walk in the blessing. The grace to walk in the fear of the Lord. The grace to delight greatly in the commandments of the Lord. I receive it now. In the name of Jesus. Thank you and thank you, mighty God. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. I want you to go ahead and command a blessing to work for you. The blessing is working for me now. The blessing is bringing riches. Blessing make me rich. Blessing work now in Jesus' name. Create the garden of Eden for me. The blessing work for me. Shield me from every sorrow. Remove everybody from my life. Destroy every yoke from my shoulders in Jesus' name. The blessing is working for me. The blessing is creating the garden of Eden for me. The blessing is making me rich. In Jesus' name, the blessing is working for me. The blessing is increasing me. The blessing has shielded me from sorrow. There is the blessing wall all around me. The blessing wall all around me. The blessing wall all around me. There is the blessing wall all around me. In the name of Jesus, I am blessed going out. I am blessed coming in. I am blessed in the city. I am blessed in the field. I am blessed in the morning. I am blessed in the evening. I am blessed in the city. I am blessed in the field. I am blessed in my house. I am blessed in the field. My marriage is blessed. My children are blessed. My finances are blessed. My businesses are blessed. My careers are blessed. Thank you, mighty God. In Jesus' Mighty name we have decreed. From today, I see God's original purpose in your life. For you to live eternal life. Fulfilled in the name of Jesus Christ. Never settle for a life that is below eternal life. Eternal life, the Garden of Eden, is God's perfect life for you. This year you are entering there in the name of Jesus Christ. This year you are entering there in the name of Jesus Christ. And so shall it be. In Jesus' mighty name.